Hi everyone, I'm Sanjana and I have Partha Srinivasan with me today to talk about A to Z of podcasting. Hi Partha, welcome and thanks so much for coming.
Thanks Sanjana, thanks for having me.
All right, thank you. And Partha is the founder of a marketing agency called Saxon Tech, where he helps businesses with content, web solutions, digital transformation, and anything that deals with marketing. And he is also a successful podcaster. And he hosts two podcasts called The East. And there is one upcoming podcast called Casual Comic Conversation. You can find the links in the description to check it out. So given his success in the podcasting field, I'm sure, you know, he's the right person to talk to when it comes to starting a podcast and monetizing podcasts. So we have an interesting conversation coming up. So stay tuned. Partha, welcome again. And shall we get started?
Absolutely. Let's get right into it.
Okay. So Partha, tell us, why are you podcasting? Like, does it really help businesses to stand out? Like, and how does it help?
So that's a very, very large question. All right. So I'm going to try and break it down into pieces. So why podcasting obviously comes from the fact that storytelling can come in very, very many different formats, right? I mean, if you look at it from the perspective of how does a company want to tell a story? You could make videos, you could make ad jingles, you could create
blogs.
Press releases, case studies, blogs, all of those different methods.
Yeah,
but then
none
of, I mean, a video probably would come as the most compelling and the most interactive, so to speak. But what a podcast does, and this is something that I particularly like, is it's a very active form of, and that's why I like video as well. It's a very active form of storytelling, wherein you're involved in the process of talking, you're involved in the process of elucidating the story. And the only issue with video is that your technical knowledge of how to edit and manage the videos after the video is created is pretty high. And so for that, you need to have specific people who understand how it works and all of that stuff, right? Whereas in podcasting, the technical knowledge, once you know how things work, it's fairly straightforward. So you jump in, you record, you have a lot of tools out there that help you process your podcast. You can clip and edit your podcast very, very quickly. So the technical knowledge to actually push out a podcast is also very, very limited. So for all of these reasons, a podcast becomes the most compelling form of storytelling, medium for storytelling for me. I mean, there are also a whole bunch of other reasons. I mean, for me, talking comes very naturally. While I personally don't like the sound of my own voice, I like storytelling.
Nobody likes.
I'm yet to find somebody who does. But
seriously,
I love storytelling. At the end of the day, it's really fun, and I can do that with podcasting without people having to see my face. So it's an engaged form of podcasting, but allows people to engage with the podcast while multitasking. So you could probably be doing some mundane task on your laptop, or you could be driving your car, or you could be in the kitchen cooking for all I care, but you could still be listening to a podcast in the background. Whereas videos demand your attention. And that's also another reason why videos or video podcasts, where a lot of people try to do, are great. I'm not saying that they're not, but it's still not the best form of engaging content that allows people to engage with meaningful content in their downtime. So that's why I prefer podcasting. What is the second part of your question?
Like, how does it really help businesses to stand out?
Also, for businesses, it's a great platform for branding. I mean, if you look at it, videos and audio are evergreen content. I mean, it's there always online. I mean, all of your past podcasts are available for people to still go back and listen to, unless you decide to take them down. But apart from that, I mean, they're always around for people to listen to those episodes and engage with them. And they may still be useful and meaningful a few years down the line, or years down the line. So as a branding tool, it's evergreen content that's always out there and will always add to your brand. And it's basically a stepping stone for a brand to kind of build on top of it. So as a branding tool, I think it's fantastic, and it builds a great storytelling platform. Brands can use it to interact with a whole different type of audience, because not everybody who listens to podcasts are on videos or anything of the sort. I mean, because they value their time a little more a little differently than people who are listening, watching videos or on Instagram reels all the time, right? I mean, there's a different audience for a different type of content. So it creates another avenue for brands to kind of build content. And podcasting can become very meaningful message bringers, whereas I find, you know, like Instagram reels and all, as engaging and as fun as they are, they kind of become very meaningless at some point. You know, it's like now it's just meaningless. You're just scrolling through Instagram because why not? So that's essentially what I okay. find the like what podcasts are like. So for me, I think as a branding tool, like Instagram, you'll forget about them at the end of maybe 2 hours or 1 hour or whatever. But when you're on a podcast and you're actually having a meaningful conversation, that will stay with you, and you can actually build on top of that as a listener. And as a brand, you can actually double down on your branding and your marketing content and build on top of that.
Okay, okay. Got it. And you were also talking about tools that is used for starting a podcast, right? So can you mention like some of the tools that you use?
So I started off with my headset, my mobile headset. In fact, I'm still talking to you on my mobile headset. And that's as good as any piece of technology you need to record a podcast. You can literally record a podcast on your mobile phone. And that's how I started, by the way. So I called somebody and I recorded the conversation. And that was my first episode.
Where did you record it? Was it on Zoom my phone. Or any other?
No, on my phone. Okay. It That's was a great. Voice okay. call, and I recorded that voice okay. call on my Android phone. I think it was 8 years ago or 9 years ago, something like that. Some obnoxious okay. number ago. But the point was that phone call was recorded, and I used that as is. Yes, the voice quality wasn't that great, but guess what? The content was amazing, and it did well. We didn't have Zoom at that time. Zoom is fairly new. I think it's like 4 or 5 years ago. It's not even that.
That's
right. So, at that point, we didn't have your option. We had Skype, which you had to figure workarounds to record and stuff like that. So it's not impossible. Now, with so many tools available, it's actually far simpler to get a podcast off the ground and still make it sound nice. But in terms of, you know, how to invest and get stuff, you can start a podcast for absolutely free because you get a headset with your phone. You have a laptop with a decent digital connection. You create a Zoom account, which is, I think, free.
Free. It is free.
You can download the Zoom recordings and you can create audio content from that. Or you use platforms like Zencastr, or there are a couple of other links, and I'll share those with you. You can use those to create an online studio wherein a person would log in. Okay. You could record a two-sided conversation audio, download those audio files, put them into Anchor, which is free. Clip them there, add the intro, outro, all of that fun stuff over there, and publish to multiple different podcast platforms.
Okay.
At no point have you spent a single paisa or a single cent or whatever currency you're listening to in this.
Yeah.
But the point, and you have a podcast that's out there. Canva allows you to make your images and thumbnails for free. Yeah. You can create a free thing there and create your thumbnails. And you have got a podcast. So a lot of people have this misconception that, oh my God, I have to go in and I have to spend $100 or $200 or 1,000 rupees or whatever it is to create a platform. No, you don't. You have tools out there that can help you do that. And that's literally the least of your worries. So the tools of the podcasting are actually very simple if you know how to look for them and where to look for them. And obviously this video will have all the information at the end of it for you to know where to start and how to build on that. So the tools, the least of your problems, you have good free tools out there, and they're a great place to start. And then you can evolve once you reach a certain stage of confidence with yourself, and then you can build on top of that.
Okay, got it. Now let's say we have a podcast up and running. So how can we start monetizing from podcasts?
So monetizing a podcast is a bit of a process, right? I mean, first of all, you need to be able to show consistency. You need to be able to show growth. And I was having a discussion with a podcaster group that I'm a part of on WhatsApp. We are called Super Podcasters. And we have a lot of really good podcasts out there, and a lot of them have already been monetized. But the one thing that we've not been able to figure out is the metric on which podcasts can be measured. And so therefore, how do we present this to advertisers to say, okay, you know what, I need your advertising money, advertise with us as podcasts, right? So one of the things that we kind of devised, or one of we discovered, was listening hours. So if you have a set number of listeners, you have a set audience that are listening to you, X the number of minutes of each podcast. So each episode is a certain hour or a minute or whatever. And then you multiply that by the number of listeners. And so that becomes your metric, saying that I am now giving you X number of listener hours of my podcast. Use this to build, give me value for my podcast. So we figured out a metric, and we now try to figure out how to standardize that. And it's a process. But to reach that level, obviously, you need consistency. You need consistency okay. in delivery. You need consistency in content. And you need consistency in the branding that you bring to the content as well. So when I say content, it's like you're not just pushing out content on a regular basis. But the content obviously has to have a theme that matches with what you envision the podcast to be. And it needs to stay in that theme constantly. Like, for example, you talk about B2B marketing, and podcasting for B2B marketing is useful. It's important at one point. And so therefore it fits your theme. And that's why you're able to push out more content regularly. Yeah? I mean, you have a content plan for the next few months, and you know, okay, this is what I'm going to record at this time, and this is how it's going to push out. And we are good. So now a few months down the line, you have an entire repository of content that you've already published. And you also have a repository of content that you will publish in the future. Armed with this information and the fact that you know how many people listen to you, how many people engage with you, you go up to advertisers and say, and now, by the way, advertisers are more open to understanding, they understand the value of podcasts, and they are more open to negotiating with podcasts to advertise in their system. So now it's actually much simpler from the last time we spoke. And that's happened only over the last year or so, I think. We spoke last year, right?
Yeah, right. So
over that time, this process has actually opened up a lot. And there are now platforms that help you monetize your podcast. And there are a few different ways to do that now. So advertising is one way, obviously. You can do self-monetization using platforms like Patreon or Ko-fi, or so many different now systems have come up. Some podcast hosting sites allow you to monetize your podcast as well. So you can create subscription models, which is a great way for you to actually monetize your podcast. So for example, you have a podcast, you can give maybe a couple of episodes, but then from the fourth or the fifth episode onwards, you want your subscribers to pay a small fee, and that's completely acceptable. And that's a good way to monetize your podcast as well. So monetization comes in a few different flavors, depending upon how you want to build it. And, but yeah, now it's actually much simpler for a person to monetize a podcast in this day and age.
So the subscription model, does that apply to Apple Podcasts only, or does it also apply to Spotify and other platforms?
No, so at this point, I think only Apple has started off with the subscription model. I'm not really aware of any other podcasting hosts or solutions that actually do that. But I think that there is news of subscriptions coming to Spotify, Gaana, and a few others as well. I mean, I saw something on the Grapevine a couple of days ago. And the way they're doing that is that they're going to actually share royalties of the podcast revenues with the podcast host as well, which is, I think, very, very useful. And I'm not really aware of the details of how that subscription is going to work, whether it's on Apple or otherwise, because I've not explored that yet myself. All of my content is always free. And I think it's a great way to have free content. It's a great way to get your branding out there, is to have free content. If you're really intent on monetizing, there are other ways to do that. If you really have to put a subscription barrier to your content, that's fine. I mean, that's a branding decision that you need to take. But it's a good thing. So for example, Amazon has this format where you have the Kindle Unlimited. So I'm just using that as an idea, wherein the content is available freely and you have a subscription to a service. It's basically like a library. And as part of the library, you can take and release books as part of Kindle Unlimited. So I think a similar system is going to come about in the future for podcasting, and that is also in the works also, which will allow a single library subscription sort of solution that will allow podcasts, and that is a revenue share and a royalty share model as well, which works. So that will
Okay. And how long should we wait to start monetizing?
See, a good ballpark is to have at least 6 or 7 podcasts in your publish kitty, because that will give you a good idea on metrics, visibility, and distribution as well. And that those are the numbers that help you build a potential value for, you know, how much effort you're putting into making these podcasts and how much you want to charge for these podcasts, right? So when you talk about advertising revenue, so to speak, a lot of people will say, okay, so I have about 1,000 people listening to me on an every episode basis, so to speak, which means that I have 1,000 listening hours, assuming that your podcast is 1 hour long. Now, for that, there is, again, there's no scientific method to say, okay, so you have 1,000 listening hours, you should charge $1,000 because it's $1 per listening hour. There's no scientific method. You need to value your own self and effort and your audience depending upon the quality of the content that you're pushing out, which obviously the advertisers will speak of as well. And how can you justify a cost for that as well? So it's talking about a value proposition at the end of the day. So that's the advertising side of things. On the subscription side of things, obviously it works out to a very similar thing, because now you're charging the subscribers for listening to your content. So how do you justify that is again entirely up to you. And I've seen a lot of people use a hybrid model where they have a pay gate for their podcasts, and they also have advertisers as well. So, and that also works for them.
Okay. So we can both have, you know, the advertisement on the podcast and also the subscription
model. So the advertisements appear on the free podcast, but then they have locked podcasts, so behind the scenes or limited edition podcasts that happen.
Okay.
So for example, if you have a Patreon page, you can actually do behind the scenes and limited edition episodes on the Patreon platform, and the Patreon mobile app actually works as a great player, so you can actually do that. So there's a pay gate there, and you can do something like, you know, deliver special content to your Patreon subscribers and stuff like that.
Okay. And you were also talking about reaching out to advertisers, right? So how do you reach out and how do you convince advertisers to...
So the advertising agencies are typically the kind of people who have... Sorry, I jumped into the answer quickly. So I was saying that typically when you are looking at advertisers, the best way to do that is to go and reach out to advertising agencies. The agencies will obviously broker the entire deal between you and the advertisers, and they will understand the brand value and the brand positioning and everything for them, and they will negotiate the best deal for you. So typically that's the best route forward. Reaching out to advertisers directly is not always possible. Some marketing heads may not even give you the time of the day, depending upon how big the company is. If the company is a small or mid-sized company, they may still hear you out and they give you the time of the day. But then negotiating deals and transfers and payments and all of that becomes a little tricky. So having an agency in the middle is always good.
Okay, got it. And do you also need to have, you know, certain listening hours for your podcast and then reach out to advertisers?
Not necessarily. So like I said, there's no scientific method saying that you need to have so many. But a good yardstick is saying that if you have a decent amount of data that you can build a story on for the advertisers to get value out of, that's a good metric.
Okay.
So try early. See if the advertisers are willing to buy it. I mean, there's no harm saying, I will go at episode 4 and, okay, I've done 4 episodes. Here's the value. Here's how many people interact with me on a regular basis. Do you think you can advertise with me? If the advertiser says, yes, you're happy, but now you have a proof of concept saying that at least this works. Some people may go in at episode 7 and still not get advertising. So you never know what works, what doesn't work. So there's no harm trying. Just understand that it may not always work.
Got it. And what are some of the podcasting mistakes beginners make, and what are the ways to avoid them?
So a lot of times, and so I've been a podcasting mentor for now about 3 years actively, right? I mean, I've worked with brands for their podcasting, but then for the last 3 years, I've been helping others with their podcasting as well. And one of the key mistakes that they make is it's a combination of different things, right? I mean, at the end of the day, like even sometimes I struggle with having to deliver the right kind of content. So what I do is I have to gather my thoughts. I have to make sure that I structure the way the podcast needs to flow in a very simple way. There's not a lot of thought that a lot of beginners put into the content delivery sort of thing. So when they actually come to recording the broadcast, they'll stutter and they'll slip and they're not prepared. They may not do their research well enough. And research is key, especially in an interview sort of podcast. You need to know who you're speaking to and what they're capable of speaking. Guys, Sanjana is an excellent example of what you need to do as a researching, because she researches her guests so well. And this is evident by the questions you ask and how you lead the conversation. And this comes with research. Because if you know what you're talking about, the conversation happens a little more freely. So that's one of the biggest things that I've realized. The second thing is they try to force themselves to have conversation in a language that they are not comfortable with. English may not be your primary language. That's fine. Don't speak in English. Fine. Because A, you're speaking in a language that a lot of people will probably... I mean, if you're not comfortable with English, I'm going to rephrase that. So if you're not comfortable with English, what you want to say may not come out the way you think it should. And misrepresents your brand as well as the conversation will not go the way you want it to. So use a language you're comfortable with. And when you're in a language, speaking in a language you're comfortable with, A, you're now creating a niche for yourself, which means that now you're speaking in your language of choice. And the people who are coming to you are... also understand you, and they'll probably connect with you at a deeper level, because now you're reaching out to them in a language that they understand as well. If you're not comfortable with the language that you're talking about, how is the audience who probably are comfortable with the language, how will they communicate with you, connect, or listen to you, connect with you? That's the word. Thank you very much. But that's what I'm trying to say. So this is one of the biggest mistakes that a lot of people also tend to make. So if they feel either uncomfortable with the subject matter and then the way they deliver the content.
Yeah, totally makes sense. And what are some of the notable podcast promotion ideas that is worth executing?
Friends and family first. Always push out your content to your friends and family. Get that listenership going. Put it out on LinkedIn, use hashtags. I mean, these are the things that help build your podcast to a level where you can get even a few hundred or a few thousand listeners within the first week of launching your podcast. And that makes all the difference. So for me, even if I've touched, if I've addressed and helped reach out to and connect with even 10 new listeners, for me, that's a big achievement, because for me, that's one more than I've already got, right? So that's always been my approach. So I don't look at podcasts as a way to monetize my content or myself. So for me, it's more of an outlet, so to speak. And I like doing what I do. But for people who want to be able to kind of monetize it, you need to, for the first few episodes, push your information out on a regular basis. Create a content plan that talks about all the social media. So you have Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, LinkedIn. Use Pinterest. Pinterest is mind-blowing. You have no idea how awesome that is, actually. It's great for hashtag and SEO value. Create a micro blog post that go up on Medium and on your own blog. Create a blog. Invest a little money in a domain and in some hosting. You can do it for as little as 3,500 rupees now per year, or 4,000 rupees per year. And create a website for yourself, for your blog, for your podcast, and push that out, because you want all that SEO juice and content to help you boost your visibility for your podcast. So, I mean, these are a few things that you can do at a very base level. And then obviously building trailers, using your network. So, for example, if you're like now you and I are talking, right? And when you push this podcast out, I am going to be pushing some of the podcasting to my network as well. So use that network marketing power as well. get your network to push out your podcast, and you will see a sizable growth in people actually listening to your podcast.
Okay. And, you know, what are some of the networking communities that you would recommend a podcaster to be in?
Oh, there are so many. So obviously pick the content-wise podcasting groups. Like, for example, if you're doing a marketing podcast, find all the marketing groups on LinkedIn and Facebook, join them, because guess what? Chances are they'll be interested in what content you're pushing out. I'm using you as a base because I know you already do this. So
yeah,
that's fine. There are WhatsApp groups out there for podcasters, and using the podcast community is a great way to do cross pollination. So you visit somebody's podcast and you talk about, you know, their podcast, and I am on your podcast talking about my podcast. And, you know, there's a lot of cross branding that happens there, and that's good branding. So this is a great way to do some networking. Advertising, let's not forget, you know, you can invest as little as 10 rupees or 100 rupees a day. I'm sure you spend more on food in a day. Put that 100 rupees on Facebook ads. Oh my God, your podcast will just boost like nobody's business. And it's great content, okay. It's great visibility. Not a lot of people know that you can do Facebook ads for really, really little money. And it's a great tool. Like a dollar a day is all you need to publish your boost your podcast on Facebook. And it's a great tool. And you get Facebook and Instagram visibility on that.
Okay, okay. Got it. All right, Partha. So we have reached the end of the episode. So let's do a quick rapid fire if you're... Yeah, but I have like more questions for you in the rapid fire. So I have like 4 or 5 questions. So are you ready?
No.
Okay. Okay. Anyway, I'm going to ask you these questions. Even if you say no, you can't escape. Okay. So who do you follow the most on LinkedIn?
On LinkedIn? My company. The companies I work with.
Okay. Okay.
Okay. No, so I have actually 2 or 3 different people whose posts I follow on a regular basis. Sanjana, you are definitely one of them. You push a lot of good content. There's a gentleman called Samrit who I follow, who's the marketing for Bombay Shaving Company. And he puts out a lot of really very interesting content. So he is one of the few that I follow as well. I recommend you actually to go and follow him. I will share his LinkedIn profile for you to
definitely put
in the content. Yeah,
I'll definitely add in the description.
Then, as far as brands are concerned, I find that there are a couple of brands that do really well on LinkedIn content per se. For LinkedIn, it would be have to be this brand Razorpay that does really, really nice content that pushes out. And they do a really clean job of the kind of the visuals they put out. The messaging is really sweet and clean. Again, very, very interactive content. And then there's a mentoring brand that I've just associated with, and they're trying to make an impression as well. It's called Expert Flicks, and they're putting out a pretty interesting series of information as to why you need mentorship. And I think it's an important piece to kind of address in a day and age when there's so much information. You don't know where to go looking for what, and how do you get the right kind of guidance to make sure that you are making the most out of your skills. So I think those kind of things are very, very useful. So, and I'll share that with you as well. So these are the people I'm following on LinkedIn.
Okay. Okay. And what's your favorite book or favorite podcast?
My favorite book has to be Lord of the Rings.
Okay.
I love that book. There's so many stories in there, and you actually get to learn a lot. So if you look at it, that book teaches you a lot about teamwork. It teaches you a lot about persistence. It teaches you a lot about strategy. But all in all, it's a very fun book if you look at it from just entertainment perspective. So I like that book a lot. I go back to it every now and then. It's a big, big, big book. Just the first trilogy. My favorite podcast. Actually, there's a new podcast that I've been listening to. It's run by a friend of mine in Dubai. It's called Karama Sutra. It talks about, you know, small businesses or businesses that have been the heart of the Dubai work culture, so to speak. It's called Karama Sutra. It's run by my friend Chirag, and I'll share his podcast link with you as well. So that's the one of the podcasts that I'm actually... I like his delivery style, you know, the interview style. It's a very, very nice, sweet flow. It's a nice one.
All right.
Obviously, I'm very biased to that because A, Chirag is an old friend of mine. He used to be a co-host with me on one of my old podcasts. Also, there's a lot of stories in there that I kind of associate with because of my connection to Dubai. But I think all in all, just the way he structures his content is a very, very nice thing. And he has, I think he's done close to a dozen new podcasts and he runs a podcast network in the Middle East. So I'll share his profile and details with you. He's also another guy who I follow on LinkedIn, by the way. So yeah, thanks for that.
Okay, definitely. I'll definitely check him out and, you know, reach out to him later. And the next question is, let's say, you know, hypothetically, you're getting your career started. So what would you tell to yourself?
I don't know. I never listen to myself. But I guess I would tell myself to be a little more careful with the decisions you make. Weigh the options. Okay. Like, I think early on, I made a lot of very quick decisions. And I would say that, you know, weigh the decisions before you make them. Don't jump into them. And that's very important for you to know.
Okay. And what's the one piece of advice that you would want to give it away to our listeners?
Stay consistent with whatever that you want to do. I mean, if you're trying to push out content as a podcaster, know that you need to plan for yourself. Otherwise, you'll end up like my current podcast, which is the East Podcast. I've been planning season 2 for the last year now. I have 4 episodes. Okay. I have not edited them. I'm lazy. All right. So don't be like me. Push your content out on a regular basis.
That's a very good advice. And if you're not consistent, you know, you can't be running a podcast like you know, start monetizing from it. Yeah. You have to be very, very consistent.
You have to be consistent is important. Yeah. You know, it's something that I tell a lot of my friends. It's something that I tell. So there's this one YouTuber who's based in the UK. I helped him with his YouTube channel. And today he's reached 3,000 subscribers in a space of 2 months. 3 months.
Wow. Okay.
Yeah. So, and this was the advice I gave him. But guess what? I didn't follow it myself.
I know, right? Okay. I think we finished the rapid fire and I've exhausted all the other questions that I had for you today.
Yeah, done.
This was absolute fun. We are. But this was absolute fun and I enjoyed, you know, talking to you. I loved your energy and enthusiasm throughout the conversation. So I'll give all of the links that you mentioned in the video in the description below so people can, you know, connect with you later and, you know, check out the links that you mentioned. Yeah,
absolutely.
It was nice talking to you.
I'm available for one-to-one discussions as well. If you feel that you need to reach out to me, I'll put my email address as well here. So feel free to push that out there. People can get in touch with me. I'm happy to respond to them.
Awesome. Yeah, I'll definitely do that. It was nice talking to you, Partha. So I'll talk to you again sometime. And thank you very much,
Sanjana. Thank you for having me. And I wish you well. Cheers.
Thank you so much. Bye-bye.